Live Radio, and you are listening to Three Women. You may think it's over. It's not over yet, folks. It's still Black History Month, and in fact, here on Three Women, it's more Black Herstory Month, and we're delighted to have a couple of phenomenal activists on the show today. First and foremost, we're having Rosemary Sadlier. And Rosemary is born and raised in Toronto, has degrees in teaching and social work. Rosemary was the president of the Ontario Black History Society, and in that role worked for recognition of Black History Month itself. She continues to advocate for racial inclusion and human rights through education and outreach. Rosemary's won many awards and honors, including the Order of Ontario, the William Peyton Hubbard Race Relations Award, and the Lifetime Achiever Award from the International Women Achievers Awards. And second up, on the second half of the program, we're going to have Karen Carter, Executive Director of Myseum of Toronto, and also co-founder and chair of Black Artists Network's Dialogue. We're going to be talking about Black experience from a woman's perspective. And first and foremost, of course, someone who's not a stranger and shouldn't be a stranger to all who listen to this radio station, but we haven't had her on in a while, Rosemary Sadlier. Rosemary, welcome to Three Women.
Oh, thank you so much, Sherry. How are you doing?
I'm good. When I think about Black history, and particularly in the Canadian context, I'm aware that probably for most people, our education doesn't do us a great service in this regard. Would you agree with that?
You know, I wish I have, you know, some of my best friends are teachers, you know. But that aside, it isn't really the teacher's fault. I think that we're still in a situation where teachers are not being provided with the permission or the backup in order to allow them to really do an even better job of promoting diversity. And in my humble opinion, one of the best ways to help to bring about diversity and to reflect the reality of probably most classrooms, in particular in the GTA, is to have African Canadian history provided. And I'm not talking about just the February thing. It was never, ever, ever intended to be only in February. February was supposed to be the time when, after spending a year of learning and doing and going and speaking and whatever one might do to gain some information, that in February, then you come together and you celebrate. Just like on Mother's Day, I hope that people don't sort of wait all year ignoring their mother and then one day say, oh, it's Mother's Day, so I have to remember to acknowledge her and share my feelings about her. It's the same idea. I'm making light of a very serious situation, but I think that we really have not done that. And as long as we continue to couch some of the real matters that I'm getting ahead of myself, but you know, sometimes we lose sight of what happens when there isn't sufficient Black history being taught, and among those things would be racist activities that sometimes might be subsumed under a rubric of bullying. And so when we lose sight of what is really going on, from bullying all the way through to other more aggressive actions, when we don't name it, and we lose sight of it, and I think that, you know, in order to correct it, we have to come back and make sure that we're providing that basis of understanding about who these people are of African origin and what they've accomplished and what they've contributed, and to affirm our kids, all of them.
Absolutely. Speaking to Rosemary Sadlier, of course, if you've just tuned in on Three Women here. So, Rosemary, you were the president of the Black History Society. And one of the things that I think is pretty endemic to a lot of people's experience of talking about Black history, period, is that most of the information tends to come from south of the border. And we forget we have our own history here, particularly our own Herstory here. So I'm going to ask you to be a little bit of a storyteller, because I suspect that most people listening don't know that history either. Tell us some stories, just stories that everyone should know about Black history in Canada that perhaps we don't.
Well, you know, full disclosure, I'm on two committees. Actually, let me just go back. What I did through the OBHS, I was a volunteer, and I made the time and made the commitment to continue to do the work that I could. To privilege the work that the organization could do as a sacred trust for the community, the black and the white and the broader community. And what I have also been selected to be part of is the Canada Post Stamp Advisory Committee, which meets maybe four times a year, and the Historica Heritage Minute Committee, which are relatively recent appointments. And I think that I've been very pleased to see this year a couple of stamps that have been issued in particular for Black History Month, which provide an opportunity to focus on some really critical stories, one of them being Matthew DaCosta. And why is this story so critical? I think that there's this idea for many people that Black history is something recent, if it exists at all, that Black history is something that is, one generation old, let's say, when in fact we know that the first African we have a name for, so that does not preclude other Africans being in this area of the world earlier, there was a man who has a name, and he was Matthew DaCosta. He was multilingual, and among the many languages he spoke was Pidgin Basque, Portuguese, French, and Dutch, and some West African languages. This is a man who we know for certain found himself in this area, in Canada, the area we now call Canada, in 1608. But because he had another very special linguistic skill to help him as an interpreter and a contract negotiator, he was able to also speak Mi'kmaq, and my apologies for not pronouncing that correctly. Mi'kmaq is a language that cannot be learned in Europe necessarily. It's a First Nations language from this side of the Atlantic, so there's a very good likelihood that Matthew DaCosta had been here on other trips earlier in order to learn this language and to become a more effective and sought-after interpreter and contract negotiator. So I was very pleased when the committee joined with me in supporting the stamp for Matthew DaCosta, because I think that it helps to place in people's minds. It jumps people back in time, perhaps 200 or 300 years in our history, which is critical because there's this idea that Canada has only very recently become multicultural and multilingual, when the reality, by virtue of this man, aside from being the first named African, the reality is that this place, from the contact of Europeans and Africans, has always been multicultural and multilingual. So I think his inclusion, and I think that his story, is really critical for all of us to know, and I'm very pleased that that stamp was issued.
That's extremely exciting news. And when will we see this stamp?
It is out.
It's out right now.
Please do ask for it at all your postal outlets, although I don't get any kind of commission. please do seek out the Matthew DaCosta stamp, because it's actually quite well done. Another story, and because I think it's out there, and I would love for people to understand it better, is a story of a woman. Of course, we have to talk about Black women. And this woman is Viola Desmond. And in reference to your first point about many of our materials are imported from the United States, the culture giant of the world, this is a woman whose experience helped to bring about racial segregation in Canada. And let me just go back a bit. Mm-hmm. Matthew DaCosta was a free African man. That does not mean that there was not slavery in Canada. There was. And there also was segregation. And that's the story that Viola Desmond is very much connected to. She was a beautician, much like some people might remember Bev Maskell, somebody who could see a need, did what she could to learn how to care for black women's hair, how to develop and make cosmetics and beauty products that are specific to the needs of black women. And she did this in conjunction with her husband. They owned a barbershop, beauty shop on Gottingen Street in Halifax. And she wanted to expand her business. I did so by going to New Glasgow, which was about a four-hour drive at the time for her.
And what time are we speaking about?
We're talking about 1946.
1946.
So before our time, right? Mm-hmm. Definitely.
Okay. Yeah.
But still in recent memory, it's kind of mm-hmm. shocking to think about this. Anyway, she has car trouble, leaves her glasses in the car, goes into a theater to kill time, the Roseland Theater, and buys a ticket. Now, some reports suggest that as soon as she entered the theater to buy the ticket, she was refused the opportunity to buy a ticket. Other reports suggest she put her money down, got a ticket, and knew no different and went into the main floor. Then she was told that she could not sit there. And that was when she was clear that she was expected to sit in the balcony. She refused to move, although she offered to pay the difference, you know, pay for the ticket, you know, whatever she had to do. They wouldn't correct the ticket, and they wouldn't allow her to remain where she was. She was dragged out by a police officer. Her hip was injured. She was arrested, not allowed to have legal counsel, put in jail overnight. And the next day when she found out what she was being charged with, because there was no law on the book about segregation, there was a law on the book about taxes. And she was charged, of all things, the tax difference between a main floor and a balcony seat, which represented a whole 1 cent. So after consulting with people in her church and following a consult also with her doctor, she decided that she would help to fight for this egregious treatment and experience, because it didn't obviously just affect her. She was successful, but the whole process was very costly to her and her family, and she ultimately did leave the Halifax area, and she died a relatively young woman in New York City. But what's important, I think, about her is that we hear so very much about Rosa Parks. Mm-hmm. And Rosa Parks was a lovely person and a beautiful woman, and I had the great honor of having met her. But Rosa Parks was a test case. Rosa Parks went on that bus knowing exactly what to expect and had a full team of people ready to support her. She'd been coached and trained. She knew what to do. Viola Desmond was not in the same position. She was acting relatively innocently, and in a particular sense she was a lot braver, because she didn't have a whole team of people ready to support her, and she did this 9 years before Rosa Parks did. 9 years.
And yet I bet that when talking about Viola Desmond, if you were to ask a cross-section of folk on the street, in our schools, anywhere, that most people would not know that name.
That's right. And I when I first learned this story, this history, I learned it from Carrie Best in when I was doing research for one of my first books. And I was amazed. And every time I did a Black History presentation, if I had the opportunity, if I had enough time, I would talk about Viola Desmond. But I'd like to think that my ongoing, broken record about Viola Desmond, as well as the efforts of her sister, of course, and many other people have finally reached someone's ears. And when I found out, and we all found out, that the $10 bill will in future have her image on it.
Finally.
You know, that was my comment. That was all I could say, was finally, because we really need to have a way to regularize and routinize and people who have done things in our own time or that have had an impact on us. And that she was basically charged for this 1 cent tax avoidance. I think that it's so fitting that she ends up on a banknote. It's perfect, really.
So out there in radio land, sisters and brothers, Matthew DaCosta and Viola Desmond, you should know these names, Black History Month, and you should remember them and keep telling them to other people, because we have to really, I think, resurrect our heroes and heroines in this country and recognize them for the work that they do. Anybody else you'd like to mention? By the way, of course, talking to Rosemary Sadlier, author, activist, all-round phenomenal woman. Talking, of course, in the last days of Black History Month 2017. So anybody else you'd like to mention?
Well, I should have mentioned it from the top of the program, and I just learned about the passing of a community activist. Her name is Akua Walcott. And Akua was the executive director of the Harriet Tubman Center, which initially had started out on Robina, which is around St. Clair and Oakwood, but by the time she was executive director, it had moved up to the Peanut Plaza. And she was a woman who had to get around with wheeltrans and a wheelchair, but that didn't keep her from doing what she could to enrich the lives of people in that community and further afield. She helped to make sure that events took place, that education continued. She was supportive, a really phenomenal person. And I was very saddened to learn of her loss due to a complication of health issues. And I do wish her and her family and her Harriet Tubman Center family all the best as they struggle to find a replacement and mourn her loss.
Thank you for mentioning her. And again, a name we should all know and remember going forward. Now, talking about going forward, what should we be doing to not only, you know, ingrain these names in our cultural memory and reality, but also to, you know, further what needs to happen in terms of civil rights in this country? I mean, we've seen lots of changes. We've seen the Black Lives Matter movement and others. And you've had this span of years in working in this field. What do you see as the critical issues that we need to carry forward into the rest of this year?
So many. But, you have to remember that what I did with the OBHS, that was as a volunteer, and I continue to do certain elements of sharing African-Canadian and African diaspora history and culture by virtue of a Facebook site that I have been managing, which is called Black Canadian Network. But I would say that the issues are just so many. There's youth unemployment, but there's also adult unemployment. There's anti-Black racism that continues. There's social justice matters that need to be addressed, and I guess that has those issues, unfortunately, as they continue, in terms of what I think I can bring, and I think I encourage everybody out there to bring what they can bring to the table to address the issues that are important to them. But for me, I'd like to think that in part, knowing that there is that we are building on, that we are benefiting from people who've gone before, and that can help to sustain and encourage people to continue to be resilient and find those ways to make differences in the areas that are important and impactful for them.
One of the studies that, of course, has come out many years old now, but, you know, talking about the color of poverty in this city, Toronto, and it's still very much the case that poverty does have a color.
A color, very sadly. And mm-hmm. I was listening to an earlier program. I'm supposed to be resting today, so I had the radio on, and it was speaking about, you know, the wide divide between those who have and those who have not. And unfortunately, we're not seeing that diminish. And I think it's too easy to, deal with youth unemployment as if that's the only issue. There are issues that affect our youth before they are even at an age where unemployment is a problem. They have to be able to stay in school. And what is going to keep them in school? What's happening in their families? What's happening in terms of so many things? So, you know, if everybody, and this would be ideal, had the means to take care of themselves, it would make things a whole lot easier.
I'm going to ask you, again, talking to Rosemary Sadlier here, activist and author, among many other hats she wears in this Black History Month, something that was asked of me actually just recently, and that's, you know, we've got a president in the White House south of the border that seems to have, unleashed a Pandora's box of all those things. All of a sudden people feel they can be racist out loud that weren't perhaps before. We're seeing it on social media. We're seeing a rise in this across North America. And it can, you know, and of course, you know, for every two steps forward, there's a step back. You can feel discouraged, you know, especially if you've been working in this era for a long time. So my question to you, Rosemary, really is, what keeps you going? What keeps you from getting discouraged? And what, you know, what really makes you get up and do it again?
I had awesome parents. and I, that's really part of it. And I have awesome children. And so I have that tangible experience of being encouraged and being advised, and some amazing women that I've worked with or come to know. So I really feel that when you do have to keep trying, and I'm a big girl now. I don't think I'm going to be able to change the world, but I do take some hope in seeing certain small changes come about, and hope that other people will also do what they can in their corner to make those certain small changes. And whether that's through their action, whether that's through the financial support they provide others, whether that's through changing a direction in terms of education or making a policy that makes sense, I think that we have to keep that in mind. I think we also have to keep in mind that despite what's going on, that we can model appropriate, and we can be the grown-ups. We can model that appropriate professional or dignified behavior no matter what's going on in the White House. Mm-hmm. And that governments do continue no matter who's there. They do find a way to continue, and our voices do make a difference.
And it's certainly, in the history of the civil rights movement, I mean, one can't help but look back and one should say thank you. Thank you to you, Rosemary, and thank you to all who've contributed, because it has made a significant difference. And it's easy to forget that just didn't just happen. That was people like the ones you've mentioned, like the Viola Desmonds, who've really made a difference. And there's lots of Canadians in that mix, lots of Canadians.
There is. Resilience doesn't always look like the person that you would think it looks like. I mean, you don't have to be a Rosemary Brown to be resilient, or a Zenaina Akande.
And by the way, because people out there in Radio Land probably don't know who Rosemary Brown is.
She almost could have been the Prime Minister of Canada.
Yes, tell us a couple of sentences about Rosemary Brown. We still have some time. People should know this name too.
You should. A really phenomenal, bright woman, born in Jamaica, came to Canada, was a social worker actually, and then went into politics in BC, became the leader of the party. And had she become the leader of the party at that time, she was an NDP candidate, she may well have been in line to be considered for to be the Prime Minister of Canada.
Again, Rosemary Brown, somebody a lot of people don't know. And she was the first black woman elected, was she not?
I think she was the first black MLA.
MLA elected, okay. Yeah, because, again, very important name to remember. Well, Rosemary, one last question. So what's next for you? You've done it all. What are you going to do now?
Well, I keep doing what I'm doing. And, you know, I have some very unfortunate people who had the idea that I was trying to hang on to the OBHS don't really understand what a commitment looks like. And I felt that I was part of a sacred trust to do what I could for the community with the limited resources that were available. And I have continued to do that. I'm very happy to have seen the actualization of the plaque commemorating the site of the African Methodist Episcopal Church, finally,
yes,
after over 10 years
yes.
of reminding the city that the money was already there to pay for it. I was very happy to work with Councillor Fletcher on seeing the William Peyton Hubbard Park commemorated. I was very pleased to have been able to work on having the genealogical records connected to the Freedmen's Bank discussed at a conference I organized of over 500 people, the Canadian Black History Summit that I did in April of last year. So these are, and to actually get to Washington to be there for the handover to the new National African American Museum of History and Culture. So I continue to be doing things related to what I love, and I also have other interests. I'm connected to a theater company and other community organizations, but people know me for this, and I'm certainly happy that I've been able to make a contribution, but it's not over, because if it's something that you feel strongly about, you continue to do it.
And we thank you for continuing to do it and look forward to the day, one day, when your face is on a stamp. So talking to Rosemary Sadlier in this Black History or Herstory Month here on CIUT 89.5 FM, you're listening to Three Women, and we will be back after a short break with Karen Carter. Thanks, Rosemary.
Thank you.
Just think.
And welcome back. You are listening to Three Women on this, our second show on Black History or Herstory Month. And that, of course, was Ms. Black with Running. Boy, it makes me tired, that song. As an activist, makes me tired. We're going to go on now. We're going to talk to Karen Carter. Karen is the executive director of Myseum of Toronto, an innovative approach to the museum experience. We're going to talk about that. And she's also the co-founder and chair of Black Artist Network's Dialogue Band, an organization dedicated to the promotion of Black arts and culture in Canada and abroad. Karen, welcome to Three Women.
Thank you very much for having me.
So let's talk about your Myseum project, first of all. Tell us what that's about. Sounds fascinating.
Essentially, as a lot of the listeners will probably know, the city of Toronto does not have a museum dedicated to its story. There's been attempts made since David Crombie, I think, first put it forward 40 years ago to try and get a museum for Toronto. So Myseum is filling the space of a museum for Toronto, but doing it in an innovative way, because instead of starting with one building with a traditional large collection and trying to drive traffic to see the traditional exhibitions with artifacts behind glass walls or in boxes, we do the museum by using the city as our landscape. So we do pop-up exhibitions all across Toronto and the GTA. And we collaborate with other organizations and archives to do our exhibitions and programming. There is a diverse cultural community association for every cultural group in this very diverse and very rich city. And the ability to collaborate and co-create and look at the various themes that make the Toronto as an interesting social experiment, really, I think, an example globally to how well diverse people from different cultural backgrounds can find a way to live together. It's been the driving force behind this approach to museum making. So we've been really happy that citizens and cultural workers, individual donors and archivists alike have responded to our taking a chance on basically building a museum for Toronto without walls.
And also, you're co-founder and chair of Black Artist Network's Dialogue. So what's happening with that these days?
We've been really blessed with BAND. We launched in 2008, the idea, and then 2009, the optimism of Obama's election south of the border led myself, Maxine Bailey, Karen Terrell, and Judy Kirksor the co-founders to do a thing called Who's Your Obama at Grano, which was our first small event. And that kind of galvanized from there into pushing forward with doing an exhibition at the Gladstone, and moving forward from that to doing other programming here and there where possible. We did an exhibition looking at the history of Caravana in partnership with the ROM in 2011. And then by 2012, we found ourselves, after having a small gallery space on Bloor Street, looking for a new space. And we had some difficulty with landlords being afraid of the idea of Black artists being in their space and not wanting to give a space. Scotiabank was giving funds to us as a gallery at the time, and they donated 10 years of free space to us in their now former bank location at the corner of Queen and Lansdowne in Parkdale.
I was there. I remember it well.
Yeah, you were there at the opening, yeah. And you can, I'm sure, speak to the energy and optimism mm-hmm. that was in the room for us being in that space, and the size of the donation that the bank had made, which we were very happy about. They, as you well know, subsequently have made some changes to where they've got bank buildings in across the city and the GTA, and I think even maybe nationally. Like most banks, they're looking at trying to drive people to doing things online more. So they sold that building, and in selling it, they we'd only done 2 of the 10 years they had given us. So they gave us some money, and we purchased a property at 19 Brock Avenue, right at the corner of Brock and Noble in Parkdale. So we've literally just opened that space this past Thursday with an exhibition called Protest and Print, which is an emerging artist looking at printmaking images related to protest. So things are going very well with Band. We own property, so it's kind of given us this ability to make long-term legacy plans for a Black cultural center in Toronto.
That's fantastic. And that's the first I heard of that, so I will definitely pop in there. What are the hours there?
Thursday to Saturday, 12 to 6, and Sundays, 1 to 5. The exhibition that's on now is up until March 26th. So please stop by.
So we were just talking to Rosemary Sadlier for the first part of the show, and talking about, and one of the comments she made was about Black History Month, that, you know, this was originally envisioned as the month that everybody celebrates what has been going on all year round, but that this shouldn't be the only month that it goes on. And you're kind of the perfect embodiment of that. You know, she said Mother's Day, you're not just a mother on Mother's Day. We don't just celebrate mothers. You know, hopefully you like your mother the rest of the year too. So again, in terms of talking about Black history in this city of Toronto, what do you think, you know, those out listening to this program need to know that they probably don't know about our history here? Rosemary mentioned some pretty critical people that, you know, Viola Desmond, Matthew DaCosta in the history, you know, Viola Desmond was kind of our Rosa Parks, and yet, in fact, most Canadians don't know about her. What would you want to tell folk that they should know about history in this city?
I think the most important thing for me with respect to Black history in Canada is that it's Canadian history. And I think if we frame it as that way, as citizens and as residents in this city and in this country, that we have a responsibility to be curious about the history of the place we're in, and that history is diverse. And so for me, similar to Rosemary, Black History Month is a opportunity for the broader society to take the opportunity to learn about their neighbors of African descent. Our Black communities are very diverse. Their stories are about the North American migration of people from Africa here, the slavery, the history of that ancestry, the role Canada played as a part of the Underground Railroad, the role African Canadians and Black Canadians played in military service, in civil service, in arts and culture, in literature. So I think your interest in your city there's a way of finding out what the contribution or contributions people from various Black cultures across the diaspora played in the Canadian context. So I think your point of entry depends on your interest. So for somebody who's interested in the arts, you may be more interested to hear about, you know, Liberty Silver or Salome Bay or an Austin Clark. But if you're interested in sciences, you may be interested in finding out about the gentleman who was seminal to creating machines that was a part of a key part of sciences that impacted things like liver transplants, or people like Dr. Francis Jeffries, who is a scientist and retired from his work with I forget the lab in Toronto, and now does this thing around Black innovators and does an exhibition that he tours through schools and through the community during Black History Month and throughout the year. So we're the Black cultural voices are as diverse as I think Canadians' voices are, and it ranges from continental Africans who waves of migration came here in largely the 80s and 90s and thereafter to the slavery and the people who settled here, like a Matthew DaCosta before slaves. It ranges to people from the Caribbean who came in the 50s and 60s post-war, or people who came in waves before that, who came to fight as a part of the British Commonwealth in the Boer War. I think no matter what your interest in knowing about Canada or Toronto, there is a layer of that that could be related to the Black cultural voice. And for me, that voice is one core representation of the diverse voices that make this city in particular one of the best places in the world to live.
Well, and that's encouraging, coming, you know, hearing that gives us hope. But, I mean, we still, of course, live in a very racist society as well. I mean, there's no getting around it. And as I was talking to Rosemary, I said, you know, and now, of course, what's going on in the White House has kind of, I've just noticed this, the rise in racism on social media. People seem to be able to express racist sentiments in a way that maybe they didn't feel so free to do before. Have you noticed that in your work?
Yeah, I mean, the sad and complex thing about societies, and especially big cities, is they're complex organisms. So we, the racism that had landlords tell us they didn't want us, either by canceling meetings when we got there, or the last meeting we had when we were looking for space before we went to Scotiabank for help, I actually had a guy asking me all these odd questions about what kind of events we were having, how many people came, did we have alcohol, did we have music, just questions that in retrospect I realized were alluding to what our real estate agent had warned us would be, this assumption that we were just going to be throwing parties in the space and that they wouldn't be comfortable with that. And then he eventually said to me, how many people did you say were at some of these art openings? And I said, it could go up to about 200. And it was like his brain said what his cheated his voice, and it came out of his mouth because he screamed out, that many Black people? And that I kind of looked at him and thought, what the hell? And it felt like I was in the 1950s in some kind of a crazy time warp. I remember hearing Austin Clark tell stories about him and his wife, Betty, in the annex trying to find a place to live when they moved here in the 50s, and he was newly married and he was still a student at Trinity College, and they would see an ad in the paper, they would go, and when they got there, the people would peep through the door and see that they were Black, because he had a very affluent British accent, so they didn't know over the phone. But when he got there and they saw him, suddenly there was no space available. So, I mean, I think as Black people in this city, have experienced and in this country that firsthand. But my optimism about Canada and Toronto is that we can have these conversations very honestly, and often those negative moments are then corrected by a positive. So that negative moment in some way was a twisted blessing, because then it opened up this opportunity that led to 10 years being donated by Scotiabank in free space, because I told the senior banker that story and he was appalled, and then went out of his way to be more helpful than he probably would have if not for that story, which then led to us having the ability after the lease opportunity changed when they sold the building, where the bank chose to pay out the lease with money that led us to buy property. We We founded BAND in 2008. It's now 2017, just under 10 years, and we own property. That doesn't happen for any cultural organization, much less a Black one.
And you, of course, you're not alone, but you deserve great credit for that. And I think it's really important to hold up what women accomplish, too, very often behind the scenes. So thank you, Karen. And that's, by the way, if you just tuned in, you've missed a lot. But it will be on podcast, and you will hear us there if you haven't heard us now. We're talking to Karen Carter. She wears many hats, and as you've heard, is the co-founder and chair of Black Artists Network's Dialogue Band, also executive director of the Museum of Toronto, which is a pop-up museum, as you've heard as well, and again, activist in the community for a long time now. Karen, as you were talking, I was reminded of something that came from my childhood, and I'm old, so this goes back to the 50s, but I was playing skipping with a friend in our schoolyard, Double Dutch, and yeah. This news, all of a sudden there were reporters there, and they took pictures of me playing with my friend, skipping in Double Dutch, and they asked us if, you know, we could talk together, they could take photos. At that point, you know, people did that kind of thing and didn't ask your parents permission. Turned out what it was about was Brotherhood Week, the Christian and Jewish Foundation of Toronto. And the reason they were taking pictures is that my best friend was Black, and her name was Marva. And I never even thought of her as being different until that photograph was taken.
Yeah.
I mean, we're all different, but it's really interesting to remember back as a little girl not having a concept of it. Didn't last long, of course, because the world pours in. But I mean, wouldn't it be nice if, you know, all of our children could keep that, you know, the sensation of, well, we're all different. But I mean, that sensation that this wasn't such a big deal, you know.
Yeah,
really,
exactly.
Wasn't such a big deal.
And I'm glad you said that, because this notion of us, I sometimes hear people say we're all the same. And it's like, no, we're not. But that's okay. That's the point. It's not to say that we're not different, but it's to say that that difference is what makes life interesting. So it's not that you don't see color. You can tell somebody's Black or South Asian or Asian, but it's that idea of them being different doesn't make them somehow lesser than or scary or unapproachable, or that you have these innate assumptions that they're somehow the other and not as human as you. And I think one of the things that I find fascinating about a city like Toronto, and I think a lot of the major cities in Canada, is that we are often forced to deal with the other. So, I mean, even being able to have honest conversations about things like what happened with you as a kid, or what happened with us with BAND, with the space, you don't deal with and overcome bias and racism if you don't address it. So what I hope happens as we start to move forward as Canadians, and in particular in the GTA region, is that we're, as we compare ourselves, or as we see how the toxicity of things that south of the border is permeating here, is it forces us to have some of these honest conversations, because normally the very Canadian thing is to sweep it under the rug and not talk about it. But you can't deal with it if it doesn't come out in the open.
Absolutely. I mean, we need to keep having the conversation, and this month, you know, focuses on that. So that's a good thing. Now, looking ahead, though, what do we need to do so that, you know, the children coming up, are, you know, I mean, and I say this, you know, I'm being utopian, but the children coming up don't have to deal with the kind of racism that you've had to deal with that is endemic still. What do we have to do still?
I think some of it is having spaces like the BANDs, where it's not only safe space for us in the Black community to have conversations and engage with each other, but also for other people from different cultural communities to find out about us. It's safe space for uncomfortable conversations, so we need to create more of those spaces. I do think we need to really get past this idea that we're better or safer or kinder than the U.S., because measuring ourselves, especially right now with the Trump administration, against the lowest common denominator doesn't help. It's holding ourselves always to a higher standard, because often that comparison allows us to be lazy and complacent and say, oh, aren't we glad we live here? It's not as bad. And it is better, but we really need to always create those opportunities to push forward. And some of it is about what the project's governments will fund, what we'll encourage the private sector to fund, and what, as individuals, we're willing to do. I mean, are you volunteering in your community? Are you taking the effort to get out there and to get to know your neighbors? Just those simple day-to-day things that forces you beyond the things that I think are lazy, especially in a city like Toronto and in a region like the GTA. Like, just because you can eat someone's food and listen to their music doesn't mean you know them. So pushing yourself as an individual, because it starts with individuals, to go further, to go deeper, and to ask those questions, and sometimes even just to own your own bias. Because I had an interesting conversation at a dinner party on the weekend where someone was saying they had to check themselves around First Nations narratives because they realized that they had a bias around hearing about issues with First Nations communities, that they weren't as willing or as open to it as they were with other different cultural communities. So own your bias, but also make the effort to push beyond the surface stuff that makes you think you're, you know, a nice cosmopolitan person, because mm-hmm. listening to somebody's food and their music doesn't make you multicultural.
Of course. And I always say, listen, if you're white, you've experienced privilege, and, you know, racism is everybody's issue.
Totally.
It's everybody's issue.
Totally.
Now, in terms of your landlord, though, who was actually breaking the law, and it's interesting because I was just talking about this over at Queen's Park, where trans folk are concerned in this province, that they do have rights, and you have to remember that. One of the things that would have been nice, because sadly in that situation, I mean, you move on with your life, you've got other things to do, you have to get a space. I mean, you can't, in a sense, that kind of racist moment, you know, if you had all the time in the world and could prosecute this and, you know, take it to the Ontario Human Rights Commission, and people don't have that kind of time. So so it would be great if you know, our governments and their agencies actually enforced what are supposed to be on the books for all of
us. Yeah, I totally think government has a role. Sometimes we think, we can't expect government to do everything, but there are laws and things that could be in place, because sometimes it just needs to be, as you alluded to, there's this wave that's happening because it's like the government in the U.S. has given people license to bring their racism forward. And sometimes it just needs to be, no, it's not okay to do that. If you're going to be that nasty and venomous, please lock that in the closet. I don't want to see it. And that comes down to what things governments will allow through laws and through policies. So I think that is a key part of the overall approach.
So very quickly, because we just have a few minutes left, but what's ahead for Karen Carter?
Hopefully figuring out a way right now. The little house we bought in Parkdale needs a lot of work. We've done a little bit with the money we could scrape together, but the first big thing is to get this built out to be the Black cultural center we want it to be, and to find out hopefully sometime this year for Myseum what our hub space will look like, landing point from which people can come and get information and then springboard out into the community, because there's a lot of great things happening, a lot of people with archives and different projects doing great work that lets you understand Toronto better. So, fixing up the space we've got for band and finding a good space for Myseum.
So if you're out there listening, do show up and look at what proves to be a great show, Protest and Print. And thank you, Karen, for all that you do and all that you are. And it's great
thank
that
you
you're,
so much.
Quite frankly, not far from here. So we will drop in. Take care.
Please do. Thank you, and thanks for including me. Have a great day.
Of course, you too. And so out there, remember, it's still Black History, Herstory Month. It was still get acquainted with Canadian Black History, because yes, we have it, number one, and you should know these names, the names that Rosemary talked about, and you should name the names of Karen Carter and Rosemary Sadler, too, and others in your community. So take part. It's still Black History Month. Don't forget that. Also, love to hear your ideas for shows. You can always tweet at us, at Sherry DeNovo. I'm the host, C-H-E-R-I-D-I-N-O-V-O. Also on Facebook, send us ideas for shows. Send us your thoughts, your comments. We love them all. Thank you for those who have already weighed in and said nice things. And we want to thank Erin, our fabulous tech today, who's held the fort down. And to all out there who are regular listeners, you know we love you. And if you follow us, we follow you. Talk to you soon and again on Three Women.
You